Welcome to the podcast of Data and Analytics in Business. We'll learn from the leading industry experts using data and analytics to solve the problems and create values in practice. We'll also learn where the industry is heading to and how data and analytics will shape the industry in the future. Most importantly, how they are preparing their business for digital transformation and disruption in the future. I'm your host, Jason Tan, and thank you for listening. In this episode, we have got Tom Verhels. He is the program director for the Regional Innovation Data Lab at Griffith University. Coming from Europe with a pharmaceutical and life science background, he will share with us his transition from Europe and also all the data analytic works that he does in those areas and how he is now building up the RIDL and using data science and data to help regional council to shape the community using data to understand more insights about the community, to understand about the services required, the services that are already in place, and how are those information can then be helped to build the, and shape the community. And I think what is really special about the works that he does at the RIDL is the data that they use is beyond just the data that you can normally find in the ABS, which is the Australian Bureau of Statistics. But it is about the extra data and also working with the public sector and also the private sector, bringing those two people together to share the data and as such, making the data a lot more powerful and able to shape and help the community. I hope you enjoy and thank you for listening. All right, Tom, thank you for coming to the Analytics Show. It will be great to have you here and talk a little bit about some of the works that you do in your past life about the pharmaceutical, but also what is really interesting works that you are doing at the Regional Innovation Data Lab at Griffith University.
Thanks for having me. Quite exciting. I've never done a podcast before, so it should be fun.
It will be. Now, I want to talk a little bit about your career in the pharmaceutical and the life science. I think it's such a topical topic now, given all what is going on in the world about the pandemic that we have, about the coronavirus. What did you like about your works in this pharmaceutical and life science industry?
Yeah, I started my professional career as a consultant and project manager for an informatics company or an informatics division of PerkinElmer. And then I went to work for a UCP biopharmaceutical company in Belgium that focused on people living with severe diseases. What I liked about it is that you, especially the pharma, we always worked on sort of bettering the world. I mean, a lot of people have a pretty negative view of the pharma industry, and there's definitely a lot of shark companies in the pharma industry, but at least the company I work for is largely privately owned by a wealthy aristocratic family in Belgium, and they didn't do it for the money. They wanted, of course, that the company made money and created them a revenue stream. But it was not about inflating the value of the stock or creating an unrealistic growth. The sort of diseases we worked on were epilepsy, Parkinson, rheumatoid arthritis. So they were really complex diseases. But the cohort wasn't very large. So it's not like diabetes or cancer. So the diseases are also very complicated. Things like epilepsy have multiple causes and can look the same, but the reason why it's happening within your body might be very, very different. So the way to treat that then becomes very, very different. We also focus on things like lupus that has similar effects. I mean, the standard drugs that work for patients, they usually go through a trajectory where they go from one sort of drug or therapy to the next until they find something that works, which sort of indicates that a lot of these diseases were a group of diseases, which makes the IT work quite interesting. So I liked it because it gave you interesting purpose. When I worked for the PerkinElmer, there were pharmaceutical clients and there were food clients, and then there were a few petrochemical companies. I always tended to like less working for petrochemical companies. It was interesting work from a technical point of view because the data is there's a lot of data coming through, a lot more than in a pharma. It's more operational data, like how certain industrial processes are working and how efficient they are. So the data is is high throughput in nature, while in pharma it's very often not high throughput. And also the people in companies are slightly different. You can definitely tell, like within life science and pharmaceutical companies, there's a strong culture. And a lot of people that live within those companies have that culture ingrained. Like I said, there are, you know, horrible examples of people buying the rights or the only way to make certain drugs and then spiking up the price. But in general, people that work within pharma, they all like to make good money, which is fair. I mean, most of them have studied a lot. So it's fair that they make some money, but it's not like they're making bankers level money. Most of them make decent amount of money, not obscene amount of money. And for the work they do, I think it's quite valuable. A lot of the drugs that come on the market work. See that by just the increase in life expectancy. I mean, it's not just drugs, but there's definitely a whole bunch of drugs that work. So I liked working in the area because it was interesting work.
I think they certainly are playing a very, very important role now, both of the pharmaceutical and the life science, in this pandemic situation. Share with us a bit about your innovation at UCB and Perkin Elmer. What were the cutting-edge research technology you experienced there? And do you think they are probably racing in trying to come out something to help with the coronavirus that we are all experiencing right now?
So my work at UCB was data capture and visualization. So I had a team that was in charge of data capture and visualization. And one of the innovative things that I did was I used virtual reality and augmented reality to visualize targets. So usually when you want to create a drug, whether that's a small molecule or a biomolecule, you usually work on a target that can be a certain protein on a membrane, or it can be a certain protein somewhere else, or within the cell or within the bloodstream. But it's usually you have a target. If you're trying to attack a virus, it is often a protein on the membrane of the membrane, like the cell tissue, the outside of the virus. So you sort of have this target, which is a three-dimensional puzzle, basically. So it's all atoms that are connected in a certain geometrical conformation, which is very difficult to compute, because if you compute them just as is, you would take approximations, and within the body, they're influenced by the medium they're in, which is, depending on the cell they're in, there's a certain pH, there's other molecules around, so there's slightly conformation changes based on very small things like pH. And so knowing your target is sort of very essential to make good drugs. There's kind of two ways to make drugs, which is you synthesize 1,000 compounds and then you just screen broadly and you hope you get a signal and then work from that up, which is interesting because it gives you the first insights. But then once you've been able to crystallize or create a structure of your target, whether that's the whole, whether that's a virus or a specific protein within a virus or specific protein within a certain biochemical pathway, visualizing that protein is very interesting for people that are going to design the potential drugs. And in the past, you would use physical models, often like these things we had in high school, like the balls and stick things, they actually use that. We use some 3D printing to create larger ones. But once you've created something in 3D printing, it's like a plastic, it doesn't move. Well, in VR, we used an HTC, I think, a 5, and you could stand in the protein, which is extremely interesting because you can then bring in your small molecules or your large biomolecules that you made, and you can kind of see how they're docking. And it gives you an interesting perspective where you can sort of stand where the drug has to stand. Some people are very good from going to the paper to visualizing it in 3D. Mm. Some people struggle a bit with that. And the things we use sort of allow people to see that more rapidly or get insights more rapidly or get better understandings. Why is this small molecule binding harder or less binding? Or because it's all a balance. Most drugs that you take, you want them to act on your target, but you want the action to be temporary. Because if it's permanent, it means you've changed the protein. I mean, sometimes you want that, like with cancer, if you would want to kill a cancer or something, then you might want to have a permanent binding. But usually you want an inhibition or an activation, which is a balance. And if you overdo it, it usually has other effects. So if you would have a certain disease and you try to take a certain drug that would have an overreaction, you might fix the an epilepsy attack, or you might fix, or you might just fix, you might resolve the specific disease, but then you might have other side effects that are as bad or worse. You know, your liver might fail, or your kidneys might start acting up. So it's all a balance. And that's where that visualization was interesting. The other thing which I thought was really cool was we did sort of the creation of antibodies, monoclonal antibodies, which is one of those potential solutions for COVID. If you could isolate antibodies from an animal or another human, you could potentially inject antibodies, which would attack the virus. But we were using them for, like I said, the complex diseases like lupus and arthritis targets. And we, in the past, if you look at like CSI, you see these guys with like these little pipettes going around. And we made this robot that create this massive high throughput. Well, you could basically just suddenly do way more experiments. And the company as we built it with then sold it on to other pharma companies. So we were the first one in Flowen, close to London, to have that. It's called the Overlord. It's a good name. It had also these neon lights. They made it look quite fancy, but it was a really cool machine. It was like there's a whole process in doing these kinds of experiments and the handing over from, we basically had these mini laboratories that were handled by a robotic arm. And then when the process was completed in one of the labs, it would sort of automatically move to the next phase of the process. And in the end, you would have, you know, whatever human that would be able to check the results, which was, yeah, it was an amazing machine. We had some coverage on TV on that. I mean, those things are great to quickly upscale and quickly test things, which in the current environment is, I'm sure, happening.
And doing more experiments basically means that there are more data for them to check and also to understand how, what is the reaction of the drugs then. But I suppose that equally means that more data, and it needs more computing power in order to be able to understand the result. How would you evaluate the use of the data analytic and the advancement of the healthcare and the pharmaceutical back then, as when you were working there, as compared to right now? Do you think it has progressed much? And given of the advancement of the technology we have got, do you think it is helping a lot more with the pharmaceutical and life science?
Yes, but it's been out of that industry for 3 years and things move fast in that space. But what I saw there very frequently is, and still you see that in that industry, the idea that you could create these sort of Watson-like things that could basically replace half of your researchers, predict what type of thing you would need and then what type of drug you should make. And you take a patient, you do a few tests, and you put it in the machine, and it will tell you what sort of drug you need, which is the, you know, the personalized medicine idea, which is great. But I think where it is, I haven't seen a lot of that being developed, as in, you know, the sort of holistic virtual drug discovery, a virtual research, a virtual doctor sort of thesis. I think what has created a lot of value and what's less visible is the AI sort of capacity within specific labs. You know, you have toxicology labs to test for the toxicology of drugs. You have the drug discovery people at the front that basically go and predict which molecules would be most favorable to make. And the robot that I just mentioned, you have a whole bunch of images that are taken afterwards, and the processing of those images, doing that semi-automatic or guided with AI, I think that's where there's so much value being created. But it's not as visible because it's the largest value in machine learning and AI within most spaces, is that you can augment the researcher's work so that he doesn't have to do the 80% of nitty-picking things, but he can just focus on the things where he can really make judgment calls, which is the hardest part of the program. So what is important, what is not important. But if you've tested toxicology on an animal, on a rat, and you've sliced it in pieces and you've taken pictures of every single part, you know, in the past, a human would have to look at every single slice. You could now have an AI that just highlights the areas of interest. And that's where a lot of value lies. And then, within prediction of drugs, so which ones would be most. So you have a whole bunch of tests for a specific target, and then you let the computer think about what other targets you could possibly make. The increase in computational capacity has drastically improved that. And then all the, within the complex diseases, the connection of genes to disease, to phenotype, to specific biomarkers. So for some of the complex diseases, they're not very obvious where it's coming from. They're starting to stratify, so they're trying to subdivide or create sub-cohorts based on certain indicators so that you can say, okay, that drug would only work if these specific criteria are met. That's where a lot of value lies. When I was still there, they were doing some work on bone research, you know, taking x-rays and, you know, doing work in that space is very interesting because it's, again, it's the same with doctors in general. I mean, if you have radiologists or other specialists that can be facilitated or augmented with artificial intelligence and machine learning, that's where the value lies. It is not, I mean, that whole idea of having like a Star Trek doctor, not your medical, what is it, medical emergency holodeck thing or hologram, and that's pretty far off. I think the value lies in getting current researchers and current doctors and equipping them with these very powerful tools, so that they can focus on what's important, because then they don't have to look at what's not important.
I agree. I think that human plus the machine approach is still probably the best way to go for a long time. Now, that was the work that you did when you were in Europe, and you have now moved yourself to Brisbane, Australia. So welcome to Australia. I know you have been here for quite a while now, but what made you transition into academy and also doing what you are doing now, which is about the Regional Innovation Data Lab, I will call it RIDL, at Griffith University. I'll come back to the RIDL shortly later, but I want to talk about your transition so far and how is your transition.
So why did I come here?
Oh, what made you transition here?
I came here because my wife is Australian. Well, she's originally Indian by origin, but she's become Australian, I think, 10 years ago. And then we met in a conference, and she has some really cool startup stuff going on here. And my sort of skills are more transferable than hers at that specific time. And it seemed like a interesting place to come and work a little bit. Yeah, I really like it here. I don't regret it. And then why academia? Well, I'm not 100% an academic. I don't have an academic role. I'm within Guildford, I'm in what they call the professional track. So it means that I don't have teaching or research or research-orientated KPIs. So my work is more to help researchers and community organizations and government with data. And it's not that different from what I did before. In the past, I would help researchers with data. Now I help researchers and policymakers and decision makers with data. I would say that in the past, the complexity lied in the volume of data, in the, you know, the sorts of, I mean, you have images that are terabytes and you have troubles getting them to a server to analyze them, and you would have to create these workstations next to the machine because it was just cumbersome to move the images around. So the problems were different. Now the data is in its, and it's collected, it's quite small. I mean, it's not terabytes. It's all columns and tables, which makes the handling of it easier, but obtaining it and then linking it is a lot harder. But within a large industry, there's sort of like a pipeline, and everything is designed to fulfill that pipeline. Everything fills into creating a product at the end, and you have these, you know, gates, you could call them, when investments stop or when they continue based on certain results, right? If the results of a certain test is negative, then you stop that specific initiative. So everything is sort of designed to flow, to make that data flow. While in government, that is the case within the department, but across departments, and definitely if you would go and look at service sector, they're not designed like that. They all collect their own data in different ways, and then getting it to compare is cumbersome. So that's the technology that we use is similar. The pharma we use, Python we use, R. We had some, of course, some enterprise type systems like electronic notebooks and SAP. Within the lab now, we use usually R and Python, but the source of the information lies in similar systems, underlying case management tools or finance tools, or in the way that the data is coming out is, yeah, similar.
Right.
Now, comparing it is not hard.
Tell us a bit more about the Regional Innovation Data Lab at Griffith University. And what is your role there?
So our role is to, essence of PAG time is making data matter. It's sort of we do in community organizations or place-based backbone organizations or place-based organizations, local governments, state departments, and then our researchers. So we have a lot of researchers that use certain data sets, could be the census, could be social service information, could be financial data, could be service data. We've seen that the need within community organizations and policymakers is often the same, or the data need is often the same as the researchers. They might look at the problem differently and they want to do different things, but they often want to look at similar data. So we try and create capacity for basically obtaining data, linking data, and then visualizing it in a meaningful way, or providing it in a meaningful way. So it's all visualizing or creating a data pack in the form of whatever format goes into what they want to do next, you know, whether it's an analysis or a report. So that's what we do. We try and create data sets that address specific problems. And usually they're focused on place, because originally the lab was sort of born out of the need to help, or the need to support Logan Together. So Logan Together is a backbone organization in Logan that focuses on kids between 0 and 8. And if you want to improve the outcome of children, you have to look at the family and the community. Because if you just focus on the kids and the parents are unemployed and don't have a job and the community around them is falling apart, you're not really going to resolve the situation. You have to look at the holistic circumstance of the child. So you have to have holistic data around the child. So that means not just ABC standard data of, you know, how is a kid tracking in school, but where is that school? How much green space is around the kid, around the school? How does this child get to school? What are the entertainment options? Where do the parents live? What is the quality of life of that specific place? What are the employment options? What are the, how is the community resilience? How is the, is there a, are there churches? Are there, is there a library? Is there a park? It's sometimes very simple things, but they tend to all provide insight into what creates a strong community and what creates good outcomes for children. So that's where the lab was sort of created, to help create place-based data sets, which originally focusing on Logan.
Right. And I do notice that the name of the lab, it has the word of the regional. So I presume that primarily the lab itself and the works that you guys do would primarily focus on the Logan and the regional council area, but not the metro. And I presume partly, perhaps maybe metro has already got so much focus already. So this lab aims to help building and understanding the communities in the regional area. Would that be the right assessment?
Yes. So one of the things we saw was that if you look at the larger, especially in Queens and the larger councils, the councils are very, very big in nature. So Brisbane and Gold Coast are huge councils with huge analytics capability. Logan actually has pretty good analytics capability. They have a wonderful team that does really good work. And Logan is also quite a large LGA, if you look at its operating budget. But there's other LGAs which are just smaller. Redland is smaller. We've looked at Gladstone, that's smaller. We've looked at some other places in Queensland, like Mount Isa, they're a lot smaller, where you know, you just don't have the natural resources that a place like Brisbane has. Mm. Just like Brisbane has all the big, obvious consultants around the corner that can provide a lot of services for obvious or a certain fee. Within the more regional places, that's not always the case. Plus, within large urban areas, the numbers of people are that high that the data available is big enough to make conclusions quite easily. While if you look at regional places, the data is not as obvious because of this. If there's less people, they tend to create larger. Let me backtrack on that. When a lot of government departments publish data, make data available, they make it available on a specific spatial geography. And when it's a metro area, that area is very small. When it's an urban or especially a remote area, that area becomes very, very large. If you want to make insights into how certain communities are tracking, then, you know, if I want to see if you have access to a park, if I'm looking at a 100-kilometer geography, that's not really realistic. You're not going to drive 75 kilometers every day to go to a park. You might do that once a month. So depending on the size of the spatial coordinate that's been made, that where the data has been made available on, it makes that in a metro area, you can very easily identify, okay, these people have these specific services and these specific amenities very easily accessible to them. Well, if you go to more regional and remote areas, that becomes a lot more difficult because they take a large area and they report on that area together. Within that specific area, there might be pockets where things are missing, and by this aggregation, you're not picking up those specific insights. So that's why we focus on more regions. We're also located within Logan, which is a regional, which is still defined as a regional city.
Right. And do your work...
That's where the name regional comes from.
Do your work extend beyond Queensland into, say, New South Wales, WA, and Victoria, or is it primary?
In New South Wales, we've done some work in the western suburbs of Sydney. New South Wales, the local governments are, again, slightly different. So Sydney is not one large LGA. They're sort of split up in smaller LGAs. And they have the same problem that they don't have, because they don't have the scale and the operating budget, they don't have access to the obvious large consultancy firms, or might not have the budget or the capacity. And then we try and help them with creating some insights into their specific communities. Yeah, we do have worked with places in New South Wales. We've done some work. Or we looked at some places in Western Australia too, Dampier Peninsula, we looked at ones. We have a sister or a brother lab in Victoria called the Social Ethics Lab, so it's Social Ethics Lab, which sits within Swinburne and does very similar things to what we do, but then focused on Victoria. Because within Melbourne, you have the same. Melbourne is also not one massive LGA like Brisbane would be. All LGAs that are... And if you drive around Melbourne, you wouldn't notice that you've changed LGA, that you have basically changed local government area based on boundaries that have been established a long time ago. And it makes that some of those LGAs don't have access to the natural big service or big consultancy firm services, more the capacity. So that's where we end up. Brother lab that we have in Swinburne try to make a difference.
Right. I think from what I understand, Brisbane is probably the biggest city council in the whole of Australia, and in fact is even bigger than Sydney itself. That is simply because Sydney Council is actually really, really small, primarily in the CBD. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. It looks weird when you would say Brisbane is the biggest LGA.
Correct.
But in operating budget and in people, it has, it is the biggest local government there. It's just because when they originally designed the local governments, I think Brisbane was just quite small and Sydney was already a lot bigger, and they split that off while in Brisbane they kept it together. I mean, there's benefits in having it as one, there's benefits in having it in separate ones. Just depends on the problem you're looking at, what's most beneficial.
So RIDL has been called place-based data lab instead of based on a discipline or agency. Can you share with the listener about this place-based approach and what makes it different from others?
Yes. So this is sort of what I was alluding to with Logan Together example. So when you would look at discipline, you would look at a very specific problem. So let's say domestic violence, you would just look at, you know, domestic violence orders, maybe domestic violence calls. But that's probably where you would then stop. You would maybe go and see if you can find some service organizations that work with domestic violence, and then you would sort of do a study on domestic violence. We try and look at a place because the place has a context. So within certain places, within Logan, for example, they're fastly developing those regions. I mean, I'll use the same example as domestic violence. And everybody knows if you buy most people know, if you buy houses that are quickly being developed for quite cheap prices, you know, $200,000 to $300,000, the plots are usually smaller, the walls are usually thinner, they don't have the insulation that a $1 million house has. So if you live next to someone that has the same house as you and you're basically a meter or two away, and you hear a discussion, some people might interpret a discussion between two people from a certain ethnicity as violence, while in that culture, raising your voice is perfectly normal, and it's not really considered to be domestic violence. Or you don't like your neighbor and you're hearing him, hear him and his wife have an argument, and you call the police. So that's immediately a call for domestic violence, because you call the police and you say, hey, I think they're having a fight, why don't you check it out? I mean, I'm not saying you shouldn't, it's just sometimes it happens that the calls that are being called out are not per se an issue. And that's because of the place, right? If you would live on the top of a mountain all alone and you would be screaming to your child or your wife is screaming to you, no one would hear it. So that's why the place is important. It's also, if you live in a newly developed place and there's no way for entertainment or for relaxation, or it creates isolation, or the shop is an hour away, that's not very cohesive for a community to become resilient. So if you're going to look at specific problems that are wicked problems, like the generational poverty, domestic and family violence, you know, some children are behind, you have to look at the place where they live, and you have to look at everything on that place. So that's why we try to be place-based instead of discipline-based. So we get a very broad view of what's going on. And sometimes it might even highlight that the problem is worse than we thought. Like the example I gave before, it might be that the problem is worse, but because everyone, with, let's say a certain community lives all together, and they have a certain view on what is acceptable discipline for children, which might not correspond to what the most Australian consensus would be, you might see less calls or less issues within that community, because they all have the same understanding that doing certain acts or have taken certain disciplinary actions is acceptable. Well, for most Australians, it wouldn't. So you have to look at the place, and you have to look at the context of that place to really understand what are the specific strengths and weaknesses of the place. Because a lot of times, the other thing, when you look at discipline, you usually look at a weakness, which is usually poverty or unemployment, or a bust after a boom. That's interesting in its own, but there is always strength within that community. And if you look at the place instead of the discipline, you could actually identify the strengths, and maybe within the strengths you can identify people that are creating that strength within community, and maybe you can guide them towards providing alleviation or build strength in other areas where, you know, there is a certain need, or there could be, or an improvement would have a beneficial effect. But that's why we look at place, because it's more interesting, and I think it's more natural. When an individual is struggling, and you ask them to go to Centrelink for this, and Medicare for that, and then a service provider for this, they want to improve the outcome of their lives. They don't want to go through a process. So that's why I think looking at the holistic of a certain individual and a certain community, being at the place, is more interesting.
I think from more the beneficial. Council perspective and that holistic perspective, from the council view, it really makes a lot of sense in looking at that holistic view by all of them rather than a discipline. Do you want to share with us what are the current projects at your hand and what are they going to achieve?
Sure. So we have a few going on at the moment. We have an ongoing one with Logan Together, where we keep providing data sets for them, and we keep accessing or requesting new data sets. So we created, for Logan Together, we create every year a data pack that goes in their annual report, and that shows progress or at least evolution of certain key indicators, whether that's, you know, how many children are going to kindergarten, or how many kids were born, how are the kids doing in school. And then we created an advocacy tool that sort of shows similar data, where are the kids born, where are they going to kindergarten, where are the schools, what are the results for the schools. Those sorts of data sets are provided to that organization so that they can make insights. So if they want to, they're basically a backbone organization that supports a whole bunch of initiatives. So to be able to make better choices to where their money, so where should they invest and where should they focus on. We try and go more granular to the suburb level so that they can make certain decisions quite locally or certain activities quite locally. And then we've just finished another, talking about the second phase for Redland, where we looked at the entire service provisioning for Redland and the island, which was quite interesting because Redland has its own unique characteristic where a lot of elderly people live in the Redlands, and especially within the islands, they're not accessible by car, so you have to have a boat or a ferry, and that leads to interesting service problems, especially some of the smaller islands. And then you have the big island where you have closing of the mine, which might lead to unemployment. Within the current context of COVID, they will have additional problem that they rely very heavily on tourism, which will be drastically reduced in the current context. That's the stuff that we're doing around the campus. And then we're doing some work for the government and with CSIA, so with the Community Service Industry Alliance. We're trying to set up the Community Service Data Alliance. I think that's probably where a lot of our attention will go next year. And this is basically an attempt to get the community service industry to share data in a safe space where they could exchange. It could be financial data, it could be outcomes data, it could be ways of working, or it could be case data, but where we basically would see if there is certain insights that can be drawn by comparing what different service agents, what different service providers do. Because there's no, within the government, they would pay a service provider a certain amount of money. Mm. It's not really per case, it's a per load. They don't really report on outcomes because the government doesn't really, I mean, how be hard to demand outcomes. For all the people, they assume that they're demanding outcomes like it's a hospital is obvious, but that's not so obvious. And it's a bit like, you know, sharing of big competitive information happens across a lot of industries. It's sort of the same where you would try and get some big competitive sharing of information that could be of high value to just improve ways of working. Maybe people that are fed up with one service organization go to the other one. It might be very beneficial if the second one knows what the first one has done so that you don't repeat the same thing because that didn't work. So that's where we believe there's a lot of value. Currently, we're trying to see if we can help the government with the current COVID crisis. And the value of the lab, something that I haven't mentioned before, but the big value of the lab is that we sit within university, and by sitting in university, we sort of bring in research expertise as it's required and of value, which means that we can tackle a very broad field of problems. Because like I said, if we talk about financial problems, for example, we get an economist to help with a certain project. If we talk about crime, we get the criminology school involved. So it's because we sit within university that we can, the lab does the data service, but then the insight validation happens by a domain expert, which makes sure that you don't make insights that are wrong or that are contested or that are sensitive. So you make sure that there's domain expertise.
I also
found
that RIDL to be really unique and different from anything else that I have seen in this space is exactly what you described earlier, that the mix of the data used, like for example, you were talking about the community data put into this dashboard to gain the insight, that is beyond the typical data that is being used. Typically, from what I have seen of my understanding, is that typically people tend just to use the data from the Australian Bureau of Statistics and to build out the whole dashboard, whereas you take it one step beyond to include the external data like the community service and also the banking data. I want to ask you though that why it is important and valuable, that's number one. And number two is, how do you convince the banks to give you this data to say, hey, this, we like to do this, have this information in building the dashboard for Logan City Council?
Well, the one for Logan City Council, doesn't have bank data. But how do we convince?
Yeah.
So why is it important? It's again that initial question about that urban versus regional. The ABS, when it does a census, see certain participation rates and certain replies, which it's not the same response rate across the country, it's not the same response rate across an LGA, depending on how, not everybody replies to these things the same. People just don't reply. If there is certain houses missing, then the ABS tries to see if that house is occupied or not, and then they use donor data. They call that donor data, which is they try to find a house that's as similar as you based on certain parameters, and then they sort of create a synthetic result for the house that hasn't replied. In metro areas, you have so many people that doesn't really matter. It doesn't really change the dial. However, if you go to regional places and if you would, I mean, I don't know the numbers, but if you would assume, or if you would hypothesize that a certain place has a 70, 60, 50, or 40 response rate to the census, you might get very skewed insights and information. I mean, we know from information that we have with certain community organizations that when we looked at the ABS data from an indigenous locality, the ABS claimed there were 1,500 people, while the community organization had information about 5,000 kids. How can there be 5,000 children when there's only 1,500 adults? That seems off. Now, we haven't finalized that, so I don't know why that specifically is. But using one, I'm not saying the ABS is wrong, or I'm not saying that the community organization is right in this case. I'm just saying if you rely on one set of information for places where the data is spread across a large area because of sensitivity, and that they only want to, you know, publish on that. The ABS only publishes their data openly in a level that doesn't allow identification and protects privacy. But if some of that data is synthetic, and if not all of that data is entered in a coherent way or in a structured way, then you create, you're starting to work on assumptions, and on those assumptions you're going to make assumptions for investments and for services, and that leads to problems. Because let's say there were not 5,000 kids but there were 3,000 kids, that still means that you're providing services for 1,500 people, so maybe it's 500 kids. So there's clearly an issue there, right? Because the government would allocate a certain amount of teachers, and maybe the information goes back, and maybe the specific departments know that the ABS data is not up to date or not as accurate as it should be, and then some circumstances are created where additional budget is made available. But there definitely will be cases where that's not the case, where because the country is very big and the data is way more accurate for the metro places. It's just because of the nature of how data works if you have a lot of people networks. So that's why we try and get additional data sets that are community generated. I think there's also a lot of value. You don't want the government to start doing that.
Yeah.
Because it would very quickly start looking like Big Brother. You don't want that. So you also don't want business doing that too much. Well, banks are not going to share data with each other. Community organizations are most likely not going to share data with each other, like direct one-to-one. Because you create, there's no incentive when you basically expose yourself to risk. But if you can create these intermediaries that can do it, that's where there's value, because you can validate things from one another. Yeah, so it helps validate if certain data are correct or not, and how correct they are or how incorrect they are, which can help you make better informed decisions. So that's why I think you should use both. Now, how do you do it? Well, it's the same process as we have with government. It's just having conversations and trying to make them understand what we're doing, why we're doing it, getting stakeholder alignment, and that's called mentally. But it's, yeah, trying to make them see that we're trying to help communities make better decisions with the resources they have. And if you show that you have the capacity to handle data in a secure and safe manner, and you've done it before, you have a university that sits next to you, then people are usually quite open to have discussions. Because even a bank once, there's a great example in Gladstone where there was this massive real estate boom during all these investments, and then investments, sort of the project's finished, and then the real estate values went down. The banks are not winning when people buy houses worth $1 million and they're worth $500,000 later. The banks don't like that either. I mean, they want people to improve their lives and progress, because then they make money. If you stop making money, then they stop making money. So if you talk around that incentive, you say, look, we are trying to improve communities, they understand that that's in their interest. But they can't do it directly. You can't ask a bank to directly interfere with people or within communities, so they have to have an agent.
Apart from the data privacy issue, I'm curious to know if there is ever a concern about the sensitivity of certain data or not. I'm not exactly sure what data would be considered sensitivity, but say, for example, something just popped in my head is, say, for example, the domestic violent case or the criminal case. Would that be considered sensitive in a way that to be put into the dashboard or into the inside that would frighten the residents or frighten, I don't know, I just, does that make sense?
Yeah, it's a good point.
Yeah.
Well, the way that we get that data is at times at the sensitive level. Within Griffith, we have the criminology school as a social analytics lab, which is basically a crime lab that has criminology data on the individual. It's stored in a bunker sort of facility. Yeah, I mean, if you want to use that, you have to go through a rigorous process where they do a background check on you. And then if you want to use it, you have to go to the physical location. You leave your phone behind. There's a terminal where you can do your work. You can create your data exports at an aggregate level that are anonymized and non-sensitive. And then there's a process for someone to check if your data is indeed aggregate and non-sensitive. And then it's taken out of the facility and then you can publish or work with it. So there is provisions for when data is of sensitive nature within the university. And we have health data too in the university that's handled in an appropriate manner. So we have the processes in place, the process and technology in place to be able to handle sensitive data. On top of that, we have an ethical framework. So we have, you know, if research happens with sensitive data sets or with data sets that can have effect on people's lives, there's an ethical commission that does a certain process and validates if what you're doing is ethical. But everything that we publish and make available is aggregated up to the same level that the ABS would aggregate up to. So it is not, I'm trying to think if there was a case where we once didn't show something, but until now, I think everything that we, I mean, there are cases where we work for departments where the data is not made available till a certain point in time because they want to validate or make sure that they have their, you know, story straight. If it gets in the news. So there are certain mechanisms in place. And the same with the bank data. If we would use it, we use it in a certain way. We have to go and kind of show what we're going to do with it, even though we don't mention their names.
Mm.
You have to sort of provide that level of assurance that you're trustworthy and that is for community and for the data providers that goes both ways. It's not that helps at your university because you're not really a for-profit organization as such. We have to be sort of have to make sure that we pay our staff and break even, but you don't have the same sort of growth ambitions as a Deloitte would have, for example. It's a very different business model. It helps with being able to say, okay, that would be quite valuable and would create a lot of visibility, but we're not going to do that.
Right. So with all this work that you described, working with the organization, is that what you call as the data collaborative, and why are they new?
Yes. So that's something that we're trying to push more and more. There was this nice article from the World Economic Forum that sort of describes what this is. And we were sort of doing a little bit of it before, but we're trying to push that name because I think it makes sense. And it's bringing people from private and from public together to share data and then agree on looking at specific interesting topics. In the current situation, it would trying to understand the fallout of COVID-19. Who will be impacted most? Where is help required most? Who will be affected mentally most or least? I mean, you can imagine if you don't have internet at the moment at home, it would be quite a grim period, right? When they quarantine you in your house, if you do not have internet, it becomes quite lonely very quickly. If you have internet, it's not pleasant, but you can FaceTime your friends and you can, in this way, make sure that you feel connected. So being able to show who is affected and who is not, you can only do that in a sort of collaborative way where business and government and the university sector comes together and sort of shares data and then analyzes it in a secure manner and provides insight, because the resources are limited. Making sure that they're allocated most efficiently is quite important. I mean, you see countries where, I think it's Canada this week, that said they're going to give $2,500 per bi-weekly or monthly to Canadians. I mean, that's great, but there's definitely people within this circumstance that will not have financial issues. And there's some people will not lose their jobs, and some people will. It might be better to help the people that are in financial stress than just spreading it broadly, because, you know, if you're a critical part of the government, or if you work in the government, you will not lose your job, and giving you $2,000 will just mean you probably put it in a bank account, because how are you going to spend it now? I mean, there's nowhere else to spend it on. While if you are, you know, a hairdresser or a person working in a bar, you might really need that $2,000 to pay your rent. So that's why I think data collaborative is important, because they allow a space that is unique in, the government doesn't want public data or doesn't want private business data, because then it becomes Big Brother and people get obviously scared. Within business, they don't always like sharing data between businesses. You need a safe space, and the sort of data collaborative model that we're proposing, I think, is of high value there, because the university doesn't really have an agenda besides improving the outcome. In the agenda of universities to educate people, to do research, it is not to favor specific governments or to favor specific political ideologies or to favor specific companies. It's very neutral. So that's why I think that's important.
I think that is a really good point, and how the university is well placed to do this sort of works. What are the important lessons you learned during this time of the past year of running the data lab and also setting up this data lab to do this sort of works for the council and to do this sort of work for the regional area?
To be patient. It's the most important lesson, I think. I always hope things move a lot quicker than they do in reality, especially when you're trying to obtain data. And it's a space where there are sensitivities that are not always obvious. So the important lessons that I've learned is that, you know, you have to be very well aware of the context of who you're working with. Since we're working with one day researchers, next day policymakers, next day community members, their context understanding is very different. The way they see the world is different. What they consider to be good or bad or a problem is different. So that's definitely something that I had to learn quite quickly, to see that there's a lot of difference. Looking at the same problem, looking at the same data set, the context of an individual is highly influential to how he's going to look at that specific thing. And then getting data it's a long, slow process. I don't think it's a field where you couldn't build a business in this. We're still largely funded by the university because we provide value to our researchers. If we would run this as an independent, non-for-profit, this would become very difficult. Because a lot of the stuff that we do is pro bono. Because the organizations just don't have the money to invest or look at data in this way. I mean, you know, it takes time to look at data and to draw meaningful insights. Everyone can make a graph, but to make sure that you're looking at the right information takes time. To then visualize in a way that's meaningful and it's actionable is not obvious. So patience is the probably most important lesson.
So what is the next step for you and RIDI, and what can we do to spread the message for the work that you do at RIDL?
I think the next steps are working with the Community Service Industry Alliance. Community Service Data Alliance will be very interesting. There is, this might be a little bit on hold at the moment, but there is legislation being passed by the federal government around the data sharing and the release framework that goes beyond just the open data. That would be very interesting to get some sensitive data sets from government. That would be of high value if we could, again, combine tax data with social service data, with bank data. That would be of very high value to just not to penalize people, but to identify what works and what doesn't work in situations of hardship. If you can identify what works, that would be very interesting. So that's for the next step. Keep doing what we're doing. Make sure that we keep providing the trust to people that they're comfortable with sharing information with us within community, within government, within private, and slowly, yeah, growing that momentum together with the lab in Swinburne.
That is good, Dan. I probably will end this interview with the usual question that I ask, which is, what is one book that you would give it to your younger self, and why is this book?
Yeah, I saw that question. I hadn't thought about it yet. there is one book from, I'll look at my book closet quickly so I get the name right, which is called Capital in the 21st Century.
Just a French writer.
It's from Thomas Piketty, which is an economist from
France,
yes. And I think that book, it's a very thick book.
It is.
I think that book changed a little bit how I looked at how money moves around in the world. And there's a lot of there to be said around how we structure aggregation of capital, which it's a very data-driven book, which, of course, I love. But it sort of shows that aggregation of capital leads to problems that are not just small problems for people, but leads to wars and other things. So I think that book, I think I read it 3 years ago, but if I could have given myself that when I was 20, that would have been interesting, yes. But I don't think he wrote it then. But still, I'm not sure if I would have been open to it if he did at that point either. But it's definitely, if I would have to name one book that I think is very impactful,
yeah,
that one, for me.
I have to say, I find a little bit heavy to read, but nonetheless, it really gives a good view historically how wealth are created, are centered and are moved around into creating the capitalism and the society and where the money are central today.
It's a bit depressing in its way that it says that the redistribution of wealth is sort of only possible through a war, it seems, based on his, which is very depressing. I mean, if you look at the numbers, it means that the redistribution of wealth was basically really most efficiently done through two world wars, which is horrible. I mean, if we have to be able to do that, to redistribute the world's earnings, I'm not saying we should share. I'm not saying we should chop up all the money equally and get everyone the same amount. But if we want to make a bit more of a fair society, because if you create an unfair society, you create wars. And then the only way to then create a more fair society is to create wars. That's a bit depressing.
Indeed.
You would hope there's another one. But it's an interesting book.
Great. Thank you for sharing that book. And Tom, it has been such a pleasure to have a chat with you about the works that you do at IDL and also some of the insight about how you are using IDL to help with the regional council to help them to build the community, to understand the services that they need and how they should be making the policy and also shaping the community as well as the building the council and building the area. And also really great to chat with you about some of the works that you did in your past life about the pharmaceutical and life science. Has been a really great interview. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. It's been fun.
And sharing your knowledge. So thank you very much.
Thank you.